So my name is Marcus White, and I'm a principal technical artist at Unit 2 Games. Unit 2 Games was founded about a year and a half ago, and I joined shortly after that. And we're currently working on our first game called Crayta. Crayta is a kind of collaborative game development platform. So the idea is that you can build things with your friends, and we do stuff like voxels and Lua and all that fun stuff. The important things that I'll refer back to this later is that we're also looking to import allow users to import their own meshes, which kind of dictates our pipeline a bit. So today I'm going to take a look at Python and basically how we used it in our studio. Unit 2 Games has only got about 30 employees, so we're actually quite a small studio. And we've got kind of, quite high goals in what we wanted to accomplish with the game. So today we're going to take a look at why you use Python within Unreal. Oh, go back. Why you use Python in Unreal. The options you got if you want to use Python in Unreal. A couple of examples of how we actually used it within our company to try and streamline our workflow. Any future work that we want to take on, and finally some takeaways. So, why use Python? I'll go compare quite a lot to C++ here, because that's kind of like the main alternative for all this. But obviously, in comparison to C++, you've got very quick iteration. You don't have any compile times, which is it's a plus and minus, because it means you get less coffee breaks. There's also, Python is quite an old language. You've got a vast library of libraries that you can actually you can use. It's very easy to distribute throughout your team, so you don't need to send out a new build. You can just commit your one file to Perforce or whatever your source control is, and then they can just pull and they get your script. You don't need to involve programmers. This is actually quite a big win for a team of our size. So with our small team, we've only got kind of very limited engineering bandwidth available. So whatever we can take care of within the art team internally, without having to hassle the programmers in the engineering team, is quite a big win. It's also, in comparison to something like C++, it's quite easy to learn. So if you've never touched coding or scripting before, but you're interested in kind of automating pipelines with Unreal, it's a great place to start. And also, if you're using something like Max or Maya, then and you're using Python within that, you can extend your workflow all the way up to the engine. Also, I just like Python. It's a good language. So what are the options if you want to use Python and Unreal? Currently, there's two options available, both with really confusing names, or very similar names. So you've got the Unreal Python implementation, which is the official Epic one that came in 4.19. This is just a plugin you can turn on. I believe it's still an experimental stage, experimental phase. And that supports Python 2.7. But if you're able to build the engine yourself, then you can put in whatever version of Python you need, whatever suits your project. The other implementation, which is something that we ended up using, was Unreal Engine Python, which is it's a third-party plugin that's freely available on GitHub, and it grants you full access to the Unreal Reflection system as well as the internal API, and it has some nice APIs within it for working with Python. It supports Python 2.7, 3.5, and 3.6. So the reason that we ended up using it was because our project started on 4.18, I believe. So the Unreal, the official Epic implementation, was not available to us. So as I said, Unreal Engine Python, you've got full access to all the internal API and reflection system. But you also get some nice editing tools within Unreal itself. So you've got access to the, it has its own console in there, Python console, as well as its own, I wouldn't say robust IDE, but it's got its own editor within there that you can use. The great thing about it is that you get lots of options for extending the editor as well. So if you want to add your own windows, tools, menu entries, etc., and so forth, you can add those really easily. So how easy is it to actually add a window? If you're a programmer, you've dealt with C++ before, a lot of this code might look familiar to you. But basically, everything's contained within this Unreal Engine module, which comes as part of the Unreal Engine Python implementation. And for the rest of it, it's very similar to what you'll be doing in C++, just with a slightly different syntax to it. So that's all a slate UI. You can create your window, create your text block, and then create a very basic dialogue. The great thing about this is, as I said, there's no compile times, and it means you can kind of iterate really quickly. So it kind of allows for kind of a trial and error workflow, which is really nice. So we're going to look at a couple of examples of how we used Python at Unity. The first one being how we ended up getting our asset ingestion in. So I'm trying to read this without my glasses on. But I'm sure kind of many technical class amongst you have kind of dealt with asset ingestion scripts before. And generally speaking, what you want to do is import and set up as many props in as little time as possible with as little human error as possible, which is, yeah. So as I said, we've only got 30 people at Unity. We've got 6 artists, and 2 of those artists are dedicated to props full time, and one of them sat there. So what we need to be able to do is support our very small team, but we also have aspirations for a very large amount of assets in our game. So we don't have the internal bandwidth for this, so naturally we're relying quite heavily on outsourcing. As many of you have worked with outsourcers before, it doesn't come free of charge. You still need to do, you still need to be able to process the assets internally when they come in. So what we need to be able to solve is supporting our small team. We need to be able to cope with a large amount of assets that we want to bring through. We need to be able to iterate on those assets. But also, something that's a little bit unique to our game is that we need to maintain a consistent art style of whatever came in. And that would also include user-generated content. We wanted to make sure that the workflow that we used internally would support whatever came in from players. So in order to support that kind of workflow, we opted to use a substance-based workflow. Not Substance Painter specifically, but Substance Designer. So the idea is that we would create a set of materials internally, which we then we can then allow the outsources, but also players, to use. This allows us to maintain our consistent art style and also prevents stuff like inappropriate imagery. You can imagine if you give free will to all the players, the first thing that they're going to create is something quite inappropriate. So we've solved the first 2 problems, but how do we solve the rest of them? How do we make this quick and easy and not error prone? So this is kind of where Python steps in. So this is our kind of pre-Python workflow. So we would get our asset from the outsourcers, then we would go and bake our control textures that would be used by Substance. We then import all of these assets into Unreal. And set up our Substance materials in there using Substance plugin, and then review in-game. As you can see, it's quite a lot. We might get into a situation where the asset might not be perfect after review, so we need to go around and do the entire loop again. So as a technical artist, my first instinct for this is to write a tool. So the way we did this was that we asked the outsourcers to prepare their assets in a certain way in Maya. So we asked them to create materials that matched our material library names, and then assign those to the triangles of the mesh. That, alongside with a normal map, was all that they needed to provide us. Next, we took the normal map and our prepared asset, and then we ran that through SPS Baker, which is part of the Substance Automation Toolkit. And if you've used Substance Designer or Substance Painter to bake out your textures, this is basically what it's doing at its lowest level. It's just running this SPS Baker command line tool. Out of that, we get a curvature and an ambient occlusion map. And then we also use PIL, which is the Python image library, in order to convert our texture associations in Maya into a single channel ID map. We then use PIL yet again in order to combine those into a final texture, putting each component into a red, green, and blue texture. So there's quite a lot going on under the hood in terms of the texture work. It's also doing stuff like maintaining naming conventions as we go through the entire pipeline, putting stuff in the right directories, et cetera, and so forth. So, but the nice thing is it all comes down to a very easy to use interface. So there you can see like the artist can just select a directory with a selection of assets that they got from the latest asset dump from the outsourcers and click one button and off it goes. So it's easy to use. There's no room for error. It avoids repetition and it allows for a very quick turnaround. So through all of that workflow, it means that we can go from this asset, from Maya, from the outsourcers. It's also from the outsource point of view, this is very quick for them to set up. They don't need to actually go through and manually create textures. But this script basically converts from this format here to what we see in the game with our final materials. Using this workflow, we've gone from our old pre-script flow at the top to a much shorter one at the bottom, which obviously allows for a much quicker turnaround. So now we've got the assets in game and we bring in quite a few assets. We need a way to keep an eye on them and see their current state of production. So then we move on to the asset overview. So the intent of this is that at any given time we can keep a view of our current state of production with all our assets that are coming in from the outsourcers. But if they're in a white box state, if they've been had the materials assigned correctly, if there's any problems, or if they're just done. But also we wanted to make sure that this is useful outside the art team. We want to be able to give a way for our level designers to quickly see what is available for them to use. We also wanted to make it visual, because artists like pictures. So what we opted to do is actually leverage Trello in order to do this. So in order to interact with Trello, we use the PyTrello API wrapper, which just basically gives you a Python route to the Trello web API. In addition to this, we also include the Perforce history. So we can see if an asset breaks, who broke it, when they broke it, and who to blame. On top of this, we also export out the thumbnails and some additional material metadata, which then gets read by the Python script and also populates this table. So you can see on the if you're familiar with Trello, you can see there's a card up there and it says completed. So we go through and we check, okay, is this, has it got the correct materials on it? Does it have any materials on it? And we can kind of trace through using this metadata, the current state of things. So that's one of our Trello boards that we set up, which is quite a variety. I don't know why it's pink. I blame the art director. But if we take a look at an example there, like the Jeep in the middle, we can see it's currently completed. We can actually see what the asset looks like. There's also, if you were to click on it, it would have all the history behind it. But if you were to compare that with the crate just top right of it there, obviously that's still in the white box state. But it allows us to have a very quick overview about everything that is available in the game and their current state. So that's kind of what we've done internally in using Python, but obviously, like Python is a very flexible language, there's a lot more that we can actually do with it. So some of the things that we're actually looking to do is automate this as part of our Jenkins build process. Try and get more kind of automation out of this, so it's kind of less manual work. Also, the great thing about Python is that it's great for just kind of incidental fix-up work. So I'm sure some of you may have been in a situation where a bunch of your assets, either the data's changed or the data format's changed, and you need to run through all of your assets and fix them all up. So this Python is a great way of doing this. We're also looking into doing some extra editor automation, so we can kind of streamline some work for our character artist, singular. But also trying, just generally speaking, just tame the art process, just try and streamline it as much as possible. So general takeaways from this is computers are great at doing the heavy lifting. Let them do it. If you're working with a very small team, you can't afford to spend time doing repetitive tasks or just doing very menial work. You need to make sure that you automate your pipeline as much as possible. Also, Python is a great entry point into kind of scripting and just kind of understanding how Unreal works under the hood. So I highly encourage you to have a play about with it. And yeah, I went through that very quickly. But yeah, we're hiring, so if you want to make our team a little less small, then check out our website. Right, thank you very much.